Titanic disaster was like a great novel written for us by history. The most amazing thing about the ship is the complexity of her story, of how thoroughly she illustrated the world into which she was born. Technology was moving rapidly ahead, buoyed by a feeling of blind optimism. I set out to make a film that would truly capture not only the sinking, but the way Titanic looked beforehand, when she really was the ship of dreams. Touching down on her deck in that little mere submersible, 2.5 miles under the sea, was like time travel, like space travel, like visiting a legendary but isolated shrine. All the differing viewpoints about Titanic sinking, all the unanswered questions, have their roots in the wreck that lies broken and rusting away down there. The more we know about Titanic, the more compelling her story becomes.
The story of Titanic, the brief wonder of her sailing and the tragedy of her sinking, is only a chapter in the saga of North Atlantic crossings. As late as the mid-19th century, ocean voyages are grim necessities instead of pleasure cruises. English author Charles Dickens calls his Boston-bound ship not unlike a gigantic hearse with windows in the sides. Of his bunk, he writes, "Nothing smaller for sleeping in was ever made, except coffins." Even after commercial ships begin to sail on fixed schedules, passengers endure cramped, unsanitary conditions for up to a month. Food is bad, disease is rampant, and the sea is unpredictable. Of every 100 ships that set sail, 16 will never reach port, some disappearing without a trace. The North Atlantic may be harsh, but the world is getting smaller. Travel and mail between Europe and North America are increasing. By the late 19th century, technology and ship design are advancing to meet these needs, and shipbuilders focus on comfort, style, and speed. With each advance, the transatlantic run takes less time. Seeking to make the most of this trend, a Liverpool businessman named Thomas Henry Ismay legally incorporates the bankrupt White Star Line he bought in 1867. Financial backer Gustav Schwabe arranged the deal with one main stipulation, that Ismay work exclusively with the Belfast shipbuilding firm Harland and Wolff, partly owned by Schwabe's nephew. The new White Star orders 6 innovative liners. The first one is Oceanic, and she sails in March 1871. The new luxury liners are being built for a new kind of passenger who can afford them. In their world, a dog arrives at a party in a $15,000 diamond collar. An elegant dinner is served entirely on horseback. Newfound wealth finds a new style during the Gilded Age, a name given by American author and social critic Mark Twain to the last 3 decades of the 19th century. The industrialized Western world is secure and prosperous in the years following the American Civil War and the Franco-Prussian War. Poverty is still everywhere, but the growing middle class now enjoys leisure time, and the upper class flaunts its wealth. The great minds of science and business are speeding up a pulsing industrial beat that drowns out Mother Nature's slower, gentler rhythms. Progress is the new god for those who want to see results larger than life. Few think about the consequences. During the Gilded Age, bigger certainly is better in the war of commerce between shipbuilders. Increasing trade and emigration demand ships that will accommodate both steerage passengers and the thrill-seeking rich. In March 1887, Harland and Wolff lays the keels for 2 White Star ships that will be considered the first modern ocean liners. Big, fast, and comfortable. Teutonic and Majestic, 10,000 tons each, will reach a speed of 20 knots, crossing the Atlantic in a mere 7.5 days. White Star's chief rivals, the British Cunard Line and the German Hamburg-America Line, must rise to the challenge. Not everyone is optimistic about the industrial race toward the 20th century. Morgan Robertson, an American writer and self-professed psychic, spins a cautionary tale in his 1898 novel, Futility. He tells of Titan, a huge ocean liner that strikes a North Atlantic iceberg one April night and sinks with great loss of life. The name, size, and speed of his ship are hauntingly similar to those of a liner that White Star will build 11 years later. This short novel, with its title suggesting Mother Nature's opinion of Gilded Age values, is widely published in American magazines. One American with no fear of progress is financier J.P. Morgan. The booming Atlantic passenger trade has caught his eye. He starts a price war with the lines he already owns, and then makes attractive offers to those British, European, and American lines who are losing money. His international navigation company grows to become International Mercantile Marine. Morgan's desire to own a major British shipping enterprise focuses on the White Star Line. In December 1902, he buys White Star for £10 million, 10 times its earnings in 1900. The liners continue to sail proudly under the Union Jack, but now an American hand rests heavily on the tiller. The White Star Line flourishes with the International Mercantile Marine's backing. 1 year after the purchase, J.P. Morgan offers White Star's director, J. Bruce Ismay, the position of managing director and president of IMM and its subsidiaries. As the son of Thomas Henry Ismay, Bruce had taken charge of White Star 4 years earlier and impressed Morgan with his abilities and vision. The influence of the Ismay family on transatlantic passenger trade has come a long way since Thomas first purchased a failing business for a mere £1,000. In 1907, the Cunard Line amazes the world with two revolutionary ships, Lusitania and Mauritania. At 31,000 tons, their four turbine propellers can drive them across the Atlantic in less than 5 days at a speed of 28 knots. Mauritania will hold the record as the world's fastest liner for 20 years. Lusitania features the unlimited elegance of Europe's great hotels, complete with beautifully appointed drawing rooms and plush lounges built by master craftsmen. Cunard now has the fastest British ship, an honor that once belonged to White Star's 25,000-ton Adriatic. The next step up in size and luxury will have to be something even more spectacular. While Cunard has positioned itself for speed, White Star will astound the world with sheer spectacle. That same year, over a pleasant summer dinner in London, White Star's Bruce Ismay and Harland & Wolff's Lord William Peary conceive a new line of ships. They envision the largest moving objects ever made by man. Three liners to surpass both Cunard and their German rivals. At 45,000 tons, these ships will be 50% bigger and 100 feet longer than anything yet built, able to carry more passengers to America than ever before. These three liners will be constructed to lure the world's wealthiest travelers with their magnificence. They will be called Olympic, Titanic, and Gigantic. A year after these three new luxury liners are envisioned, signatures on a contract set the dream in motion. Bruce Ismay, Harold Sanderson, and other ranking White Star members arrive in Belfast to review Harland & Wolff's construction plans for these three new wonder ships. William Peary presents the drawings, assisted by his nephew and managing director, Thomas Andrews. The contract, signed on July 31st, states that Harland and Wolff will begin construction of two liners now and the third later. This agreement signals an economic boom for Belfast, whose lifeblood is shipbuilding, and a higher profile for Southampton, fast becoming England's leading passenger port. White Star encourages Harland and Wolff's designers to pursue their vision of grandeur with no expense spared. The planners and draftsmen propose huge liners whose passenger amenities will make them the most awesome vessels afloat. First-class passengers will make their dramatic entrances and exits on a sweeping grand staircase beneath an elegant dome of glass and iron. First and second-class passengers will also have elevators to carry them between decks. The middle deck will feature a swimming pool for passenger fitness. A Turkish bath will make soothing relaxation possible even on the high seas. The extravagance must be obvious to all. Alexander Carlyle is the chief designer who oversees this vision. After his retirement next year, it will be Thomas Andrews who brings to life every detail of these ships. The next generation of ocean liners moves from the draftsman's table to the real world of the ship workers. To accommodate the building of these massive liners, Harland and Wolff must convert three of their already enormous berths into two bigger ones. By the end of the year, they have built the tallest gantry ever, which towers over Belfast, and laid Olympic's first keel plate beneath it. They are hiring ship workers in record numbers. The channel of the River Lagan must be dredged to 50 feet for ships with a deeper draft. In Southampton, White Star arranges for similar dredging. Meanwhile, Bruce Ismay is in America, doing whatever is necessary to ensure that the piers in New York Harbor will be long enough for his liners to dock. On March 31, ship workers lay Titanic's first keel plate next to Olympic. As construction continues, White Star prepares the world for the first passenger liners to exceed 40,000 tons, floating luxury hotels with pools, palm trees, and no end of elegant detail. To evoke their mythic stature, Bruce Ismay has drawn his new ship's names from Greek mythology. Olympic is named for Mount Olympus, home of the gods. Titanic honors the Titans, powerful giants who challenged the gods, only to have their arrogance punished by a spectacular defeat. Ismay is obviously impressed by the Titans' size and strength, not their ultimate fate. In 1909, all ships need to carry lifeboats, but not everyone agrees on how many. Though final plans for Titanic and Olympic call for 16 boats each, plus four Engelhart collapsible boats that can be stored more easily, designer Alexander Carlyle originally saw 48 and possibly even 64 boats per ship, using new davits by the Welland Company. Bruce Ismay disagrees with Carlyle, claiming that 48 lifeboats will take up too much deck space and cause passengers to worry. In the end, 20 boats with a total of 1,178 seats are considered adequate for 3,547 passengers and crew. In fact, Titanic and Olympic will actually exceed the outdated British Board of Trade requirements by 17%. But this still isn't enough lifeboats to accommodate every passenger. On May 31st, 1911, Lord and Lady Peary, both celebrating birthdays, host a group of distinguished visitors in Belfast for the launch of Titanic. Aided by 23 tons of soap, tallow, and train oil spread on the slipway, the ship slides easily into the River Lagan, reaching 12 knots and coming to a gentle stop 1 minute later. She is then towed to the fitting out basin for completion. Shipworker James Dobbins had been fatally injured by a falling support during Titanic's launch. Unaware of the mishap, White Star officials celebrate over lunch, accept the now completed Olympic, and sail her to Liverpool to prepare for her maiden voyage. Like the Olympic, Titanic's safety features set new standards for marine technology. Harland and Wolff has given Titanic a double-plated keel and a system of watertight compartments that allow any two of them to flood without sinking the ship. Alternately, towards the front of the ship, she would be safe if any three of the first five compartments were to flood. Even in a worst-case scenario, if every single one of the first four compartments were to fill with water, the ship could conceivably stay afloat. Should the hull ever be punctured in one or more places, electric watertight doors would close automatically. Powerful pumps will empty each flooding compartment long before water can reach the gaps between the top of the bulkheads and the ceiling plates. Shipbuilder magazine calls White Star's huge new ships practically unsinkable. In the public mind, this is as good as just plain unsinkable. Expectations for Titanic now run even higher. Even unsinkable ships can have accidents. As Olympic leaves Southampton on her fifth voyage, the Navy cruiser HMS Hawk suddenly veers toward her and rams her midship on the starboard side. Hawk thrusts 8 feet into the vast hull, tearing a 40-foot gash below the waterline. Olympic is towed to Belfast for repairs. Naval engineers determined that water displacement caused by the huge vessel had swept the much smaller boat into its wake. Work on Olympic delays Titanic's scheduled maiden voyage by 3 weeks. Because of this and a previous accident with a smaller vessel, some suggest that the new ships are just too big. To the people of Belfast, the wonder ships that rise above the local skyline are the pride of their city. Harland and Wolff employs nearly 15,000 men, most of whom have bent their backs in labor over Olympic and Titanic. Although the work is hard, hours long, vacations few, and they certainly couldn't afford a first-class passage on the ships they build, the men and their families feel a personal attachment to these great liners. For these craftsmen, there is no greater satisfaction than to have the eyes of the world rest admiringly upon their work. On March 31, 1912, Titanic, the world's largest ship, is completed. Her 882-foot hull is built of more than 2,000 inch-thick steel plates, held together by more than 3 million rivets. Two massive anchors will hold her in place, one for each side, with a third stored in reserve on the forecastle. 29 boilers drive her two colossal reciprocating engines and single turbine, generating up to 46,000 horsepower. Her displacement weight is 52,310 tons, even more than Olympic. The cost of building and fully equipping Titanic has come to £1.5 million, or $7.5 million, nearly $125 million by today's standards. The White Star Line anticipates a quick and glorious return on its investment. Two days after her completion, Titanic's officers conduct her sea trials in Belfast Lough. They practice making turns with this huge new ship, then steam her out towards the North Channel, practice more turns, and bring her back after 4.5 hours. Satisfied with her performance, the officials at Harland and Wolff proclaim Titanic fit to sail. Bruce Ismay accepts her on behalf of the White Star Line. At 8 p.m., the largest ship in the world leaves Belfast for Southampton. At midnight on April 3rd, after steaming down Britain's west coast and passing her sister ship Olympic at sea, Titanic arrives at the White Star Dock in Southampton. She will have a week to prepare for her maiden voyage. White Star begins to recruit most of the necessary crew members on Saturday, April 6th. They will take on about 900 people, including a deck crew of over 50, nearly 100 stokers, 35 engineers, and 300 stewards and stewardesses. That same Saturday, the first of the cargo arrives at the dock for loading. There will be 559 tons in all, including practical items like textiles, machinery, and furniture, as well as more unusual things such as anchovies, golf balls, tennis balls, and ostrich feathers. For Titanic to sail, she must have coal, 5,892 tons of it. Normally, this would be easy. However, a coal strike has gripped Britain since late February. Shipping, rail lines, and much industry is at a near standstill. To ensure that its massive new liner will have enough coal to sail on schedule, the White Star Line cancels two other ships' departures and buys coal from outside sources. Because of the strike, there is no money coming into the many local households that earn their living from the sea. When Titanic finally does steam out of the River Test, three-quarters of her crew will be Southampton residents, making many Southampton families happy that there is work again. For the crew who have signed on to sail the ship and serve her passengers, Titanic is unlike anything they have seen. A few have worked on Olympic, but to everyone else, it is a challenge to remember names and locations on so big a ship.
It is difficult to convey any idea of the size of a ship like the Titanic, when you could actually walk miles along decks and passages, covering different ground all the time. It took me 14 days before I could with confidence find my way from one part of that ship to another by the shortest route. Second Officer Charles Lightoller.
Captain Edward J. Smith boards Titanic on Sunday. The very soul of grace and confidence, his pleasant attitude and pristine record make him the ideal commander. Crew members respect him, and wealthy passengers go out of their way to sail with him. Some have even switched their bookings to Titanic when learning that he'll be in command. He explained why passengers and crew feel safe under his command.
When anyone asks me how I can best describe my experience in nearly 40 years at sea, I merely say, uneventful. In all my experience, I've never been in any accident, or any sort worth speaking about. Captain Edward J. Smith.
Now, after 32 years and more than 2 million ocean miles with White Star, after achieving the rank of Commodore at more than double the salary of his counterparts on the Cunard Line, the 59-year-old captain will retire when Titanic returns from New York. Wednesday, April 10th. Titanic's maiden voyage begins at noon, and the sailing hour draws near. After years of advanced publicity, and with the sheer size and elegance of its liners, White Star has at last created the spectacle it desires. Throughout the morning, Southampton fills with sightseers. The waterfront is lined with onlookers and well-wishers. Photographers and news reporters are everywhere. Anticipation hangs tangibly in the air. Titanic is a wonder of modern marine engineering, but the general public is impressed by something else: luxury. The grand staircase spans six decks with its graceful sweep of paneled and carved oak surfaces. Behind it are three elevators for those who choose to ride. The first-class staterooms and suites are elegantly appointed, and each suite has a private bathroom. Their occupants can dine in the dining saloon or in the a la carte restaurant. There are lounges for all, smoking rooms for men, a writing room for ladies, a library for second-class passengers. Those seeking exercise may visit the gymnasium, swimming pool, or squash court. Those in need of deep relaxation will find it in the Turkish bath. Second-class passengers can expect courteous, if less regal, versions of the first-class public rooms and personal services. Even the steerage passengers are given more privacy and better food than they might expect on a lesser ship. At 10 a.m., White Star's chartered boat train from Waterloo Station pulls up next to Titanic. In addition to travelers from London, the train also carries people from Liverpool whose ships have been docked by the coal strike. All begin to board the ship from special gangways that connect directly to the railway carriages. Titanic's range of passengers is like a cross-section of the Edwardian society that has made her possible. Whether they are magnates and heirs happy to spend thousands of pounds on a transatlantic jaunt, or humble people who have earned their passage to America and the shops and mills of the wealthy, all are ready to entrust their lives to Titanic for the next week. Many of Titanic's second-class passengers hold first-class tickets for Oceanic or Majestic, less elegant White Star liners whose voyages were canceled when their coal supplies were transferred to Titanic. These are educated middle-class people like Lawrence Beasley, a vacationing science professor from London's Dulwich College. These are families en route, such as the Beckers, American missionaries returning from India. Their accommodations on Titanic, while lacking the famous grandeur and privilege of first class, will be as comfortable as any modern stateroom on another ship. Before Titanic sails, her second class passengers are allowed to tour the more luxurious areas of the wonder ship. As the passengers board, Titanic's crew conducts a lifeboat drill under the watchful gaze of Captain Maurice Clark and other Board of Trade inspectors. Sailors at the davits swing out a few of the boats and lower them with junior officers and other sailors aboard. They disconnect a small craft from their falls and row out into the harbor. The simulated escape is complete, and the inspectors are satisfied. By legal standards, Titanic's lifeboats are now considered safe and adequate. She is officially free to sail. At the stroke of noon on Wednesday, April 10th, Titanic's huge steam whistle bellows. Her lines are cast off, and she eases away from her berth. Passengers crowd the deck rails to wave their jubilant farewells to those on the dock. Photographers click away wildly. One newsman is thoroughly impressed.
The vision of the great liner as she moved away from Southampton Quay forms an imperishable memory. She looks so colossal and so queenly.
Five tugboats lead Titanic through the channel of the River Test. History is being made. Titanic's propellers turn as the tugs cast off their lines. Her size and power set up a strong current in the narrow, crowded channel. A ship owned by the American line, the steamer New York, rises on Titanic's swell. As she falls, her lines break with sounds like gunshots. Her bow is sucked uncontrollably into Titanic's wake. Harbor pilot George Boyer reverses Titanic's engines at the last second. The tugboat Vulcan heads off the drifting liner, stopping her just 4 feet from Titanic's hull. Titanic waits for New York to be floated out of the way before cautiously proceeding. Now 1 hour behind schedule, she turns into Southampton water and makes for open sea. The near collision with the steamer New York is an exciting send-off from Southampton, but many of Titanic's passengers are too busy with their first lunch to watch the maneuvers that follow. In the rhythm of shipboard life, meals are the perfect social event, whether to catch up with old friends or make new ones. First and second classes have an array of lounges, reception areas, smoking rooms, and other places to congregate. Third class has fewer options, but all have free access to a designated deck space. Crossing the English Channel on a sunny afternoon, passengers are eager to explore their floating palace. By sunset, Titanic arrives at the deepwater port of Cherbourg, France, 77 miles south of Southampton. She rides at anchor while passengers, baggage, and mail bags are ferried from the dock by Nomadic and Traffic, two specially designed White Star tenders. Of the 274 new passengers, half are wealthy travelers on vacation, and over one-third are emigrants from Europe and the Middle East. 24 people and one canary leave the ship after history's most glamorous cross-channel commute. By 8:30, Titanic is ready to leave Cherbourg. Her lights sparkle in the clear evening as she raises anchor and steams out into the English Channel. Most of the first-class passengers joining Titanic at Cherbourg are wealthy Americans and Britons, accustomed to the luxury they are about to experience. Millionaire John Jacob Astor IV and his young wife Madeline are returning from their honeymoon, braced for scandal in New York. Outspoken philanthropist Margaret Molly Brown, fashion designer Lucille Lady Duff Gordon, and her titled husband Sir Cosmo. President Taft's military advisor, Major Archibald Butt. Mining tycoon Benjamin Guggenheim and his mistress, Madame Aubert. The list goes on. This is the royalty of the Gilded Age, the who's who of high society. Captain Smith will greet them all personally. No expense has been spared for their comfort and pleasure. These are the people on whom Titanic's image was built. At noon on Thursday the 11th, Titanic drops anchor at Cove Harbor, the deep water port of Queenstown, Ireland. Two tenders, the Ireland and the America, bring aboard port officials, journalists, 120 passengers, their luggage, and nearly 1,500 mail bags. A select group of temporary visitors board here as well. They're local vendors, picked by Chief Officer Wilde to sell lace and souvenirs to first-class passengers on the promenade deck during the stop. The arrangement provides vendors with wealthy clientele, and Wilde receives a tip for allowing them to board. One of the eight people to disembark at Queenstown is 32-year-old Francis M. Brown, a teacher at Belvedere College in Dublin who is studying for the priesthood. He has been snapping casual photographs during the trip from Southampton. His images are the last to show passenger life aboard Titanic as she was in April 1912. At 1:30 p.m., Titanic raises anchor for the last time, steams down St. George's Channel, and makes for the open sea. Almost all new passengers are young Irish people traveling third class. Now there are over 700 men, women, and children in steerage. They come from over a dozen lands, leaving behind their families, histories, and old lives to follow a 70-year wave of emigrants seeking a better life in America. And they're the true bread and butter of the transatlantic passenger trade, the real reason for Titanic's incredible size. Their cabins may be small and rude compared to first class, but with such large hopes and sacrifices, they're grateful to be westbound toward a new future in a new world. Even at sea, Titanic's wealthy passengers can still send and receive telegrams. A powerful Marconi wireless setup puts them in contact with their world. Most liners who offer this service have a single operator at the Morse key, but Titanic has two telegraphists on the job for 24-hour service. Jack Phillips and Harold Bride, like many young men in the last few years, have seen the future in wireless communication and attended a special Marconi school to learn this exciting new trade. Using Titanic's call letters MGY, they will broadcast the words of her passengers 500 to 1,500 miles beyond the flat horizon.
The sky was blue and the sea a lazy calm as far as the eye could see every day. Contentment and restfulness following the recent strain of departure spread over the Titanic as she cut her way proudly across the Atlantic. Stewardess Violet Jessop.
Jessop seems to speak for everyone on Titanic.
You don't notice anything of the movement of the ship. On top deck, there are 20 boys marching around and singing. Others are playing cards and dominoes. Some reading and some writing. Everything is quite different to what we thought to see at sea. Second class passenger Henry P. Hodges.
Titanic's third class general room is busy with the voices of many languages. No matter where they come from, men, women, and children are united in their journey to America. Within these walls, the uncertain world becomes a smaller, friendlier place. Although the voyage is off to a perfect start, the sea is not without its dangers. On the evening of Friday, April 12th, Titanic receives her first ice warning. The sender is Captain Coussin of the French liner La Touraine. His message is directed to Captain Smith. Wireless operator Harold Bride passes this message on to the bridge. The officers, however, find no cause for alarm. North Atlantic ice is a common occurrence in the early spring. Captain Smith gives the position of reported ice to Fourth Officer Boxhall, who marks the location on the map in the chart room. The next afternoon, Saturday, Mrs. Elizabeth Lyons overhears a telling conversation between Bruce Ismay and Captain Smith in the first class reception room.
The press knows the size of Titanic. Now I want them to marvel at her speed. We must give them something new to print. This maiden voyage of Titanic must make headlines.
Mr. Ismay, I would prefer not to push the engines until they've been properly run in.
As I'm just a passenger, I leave it to your good offices to decide what's best. What a glorious end to your final crossing if we were to get into New York on Tuesday night and surprise them all. Make the morning papers. Retire with a bang, eh, EJ? Good man.
On Saturday evening, April 13th, Titanic receives an ice warning, her second, via Morse lamp from the crippled steamer Rappahannock. Sailing eastward from Halifax to London, the Furness-Withy Line's ship has damaged her rudder and bow in heavy ice not too far to the west. Titanic flashes a brief acknowledgement and continues on course. No mention of the warning is posted in the chart room. Titanic's wireless transmitter stops working near midnight on Saturday. Operator Phillips examines the condensers all night long, finally discovering and repairing the burnt wire that grounded the system. Back on the air by 5 a.m., Phillips and Bride are now 6 hours behind on their work. Early Sunday morning, as soon as the wireless equipment is again functional, Titanic receives her third ice warning, this from the Cunard Line's Caronia. This message, addressed to Captain Smith, says, "Field ice and icebergs at 42 degrees north, from 49 to 51 degrees west." Smith begins his Sunday by posting the warning on the wall in the chart room. Second Officer Lightoller marks the location on the map and calculates that they will reach this position at around 11 p.m. Of the three warnings received, this is the first one given significant attention in the chart room. Sunday aboard Titanic, church services are held in every class. Captain Smith leads the prayers in the first class dining room. In spite of appeals for divine guidance, there is still a human element at work. At 11:40 a.m., Titanic receives her fourth ice warning. The Dutch liner Nordam, addressing Captain Smith, sends a report of much ice in the region described by the Caronia. Smith has the wireless operators acknowledge the message, but he does not post it on the map. Of four warnings, still only one has been prominently posted in the chart room. No one can suspect that the officers have only 12 hours left to take the ice warning seriously. The temperature dips, and all but the hardiest passengers move inside. The White Star liner Baltic sends Titanic an ice warning from the Greek steamer Athene, describing large quantities of field ice 250 miles dead ahead. This message, arriving at 1:42 p.m., is the ship's fifth ice warning. This also fails to appear in the chart room. Captain Smith hands it to Bruce Ismay on the promenade deck, but their exact conversation can only be guessed. Ismay pockets the message and heads down to lunch. At 2 p.m., Titanic's wireless operators receive yet another ice warning. This sixth one is from a German steamer called America. She reports passing several large icebergs. Jack Phillips does not pass this message on to Titanic's officers because it is not addressed to Titanic. As wireless protocol dictates, Phillips handles the communication only because America, whose signal is much weaker, needs the help of other ships to relay her message. Unfortunately, only one of the six ice warnings has been posted for all the officers to see. Together, all six of these ice warnings have been describing parts of a large ice field lying directly across the North Atlantic shipping lanes. Ice is not unheard of here, but this much of it is unusual for mid-April. A warm winter has led to excessive melting of the Greenland glaciers. A carpet of broken ice drifts southward on the Labrador Current. Captain Smith, unaware of the magnitude, corrects Titanic's course by swinging her bow due west 10 miles south of the usual turning point on this route. He plans to speed around the bottom of what he thinks is a much smaller obstacle. But Smith cannot know that for all of her grandeur and her many safety features, Titanic is still closing in fast on the very ice field that he hopes to avoid. By 7 p.m., the biting north wind dies down and passengers venture on deck to marvel at the last glow of the sunset off the port bow. Mrs. Marie Gerwan looks back on her perfect day.
The weather was exceptional. The trip was one of the most beautiful of the season. We had at our disposal three walking decks and a very large, well-appointed lounge where there were concerts twice a day. The passengers prepared for a concert on Monday, the profits from which were to be for poor shipwrecked sailors.
For reasons unknown, Captain Smith had canceled the scheduled lifeboat drill, preventing an afternoon of worrisome thoughts on an unsinkable ship. At 6 p.m., Mrs. Emily Ryerson, watching the sunset with Mrs. Marion Thayer from the aft end of the promenade deck, hears word of an ice warning from Bruce Ismay.
Mr. Ismay thrust a marconogram at me, saying we were in among the icebergs. They were to start up extra boilers that afternoon. My impression was that they were speeding the ship up to get away from the ice, and that we would probably get in late Tuesday night or early Wednesday morning. Mr. Ismay's manner was that of one in authority and the owner of the ship, and that what he said was law.
Captain Smith will later ask Ismay to return the ice warning so that he can post it in the chart room.
All ahead, Bull.
At 7 p.m., the bridge telegraphs the engine room. Full speed ahead. The stokers get the message and fire up the last three boilers.
Come on! Put your back seat quick!
Once Chief Engineer Bell connects them, Titanic will soon sail under a full head of steam at or near her top speed of about 22 knots. Bruce Ismay's request for speed will be honored, but speed has its disadvantages. The faster Titanic goes, the less precisely she will be able to turn. At 7:30 p.m., wireless operator Bride arrives at the bridge with an ice message. He hands it to First Officer Murdoch. This, the ship's seventh warning, comes from the Leyland Line's Californian. Wireless operator Phillips has just relayed to Leyland's Antillean as a favor for Californian. The relayed warning does not make its way to the chart room. The ice is reportedly 50 miles away. Titanic is sailing straight into it at nearly full speed.
Good evening, sir.
For the first class passengers, this voyage has been like a glorious dream. Their new surroundings are exquisite, and the service is excellent. The rich, the powerful, and the beautiful mingle in spectacular surroundings. Old and new friends appear in their finest clothing for Sunday dinner, the best meal yet.
The pleasure and comfort which all of us enjoyed upon this floating palace with its extraordinary provisions for such purposes seemed an ominous feature to many of us, including myself, who felt it almost too good to last. First class passenger, Archibald Gracie.
Even as the wealthy passengers raise their glasses, a large party resumes in the third class general room, only one deck below, but in another world. This is the continuation of an event that began in mid-afternoon. With no band provided for the third-class passengers, they play their own instruments to accompany their dancing. Captain Smith leaves his dinner party early, returning to the bridge by 8:55 p.m. to check on Titanic's approach to the ice.
Clear.
Yes. I don't think I've ever seen such a flat calm.
Like a mill pond. Not a breath of wind.
It will make the bergs harder to see, with no breaking water at the base.
Well, I'm off. Maintain speed on heading, Mr. Lytle.
Yes, sir.
Titanic receives her eighth ice warning at 9:30 p.m. The Atlantic transport liner Mesaba describes an ice field at 42 to 41 degrees 25 minutes north by 49 to 50 degrees 30 minutes west. The exhausted wireless operator Jack Phillips acknowledges the message, but does not pass it on to the bridge. His partner Harold Bride is asleep, and Phillips, hours behind on his work, is no navigator. He does not understand the implications of the six ice warnings that have passed through his hands today. A 78-mile band of ice floating further south than normal. Tragically, only one of these ice warnings has been posted prominently in the chart room. No one capable of understanding Titanic's collision course has seen all the information that could lead her to avoid it. Ten p.m. The sea southeast of the Grand Banks is calm, The cloudless, moonless sky is filled with stars, and the temperature is 32 degrees Fahrenheit.
God, it's bloody cold. You know, I can smell ash, you know.
Lookouts Frederick Fleet and Reginald Lee take over from George Simons and Archie Jewell in the Crow's Nest, prepared to watch for ice. First Officer Murdoch arrives on the bridge, relieving Second Officer Lightoller. Meanwhile, the lights in the third-class common areas are extinguished, ending the party. p.m. Titanic receives a message that Californian is stopped for the night, surrounded by ice. This is the ninth and final ice warning.
Look at this one. He wants his private train to meet him. La-di-da. We'll be up all bloody night on this lot.
You'll be up all bloody night on that lot.
Oh, yeah?
All right.
You're joking.
Bloody hell!
It's that idiot on the Californian.
Tell him to sod off.
Keep out! Shut up! I'm working.
Take race.
Arrogant bastard. I try and warn him about the ice and he tells me to shut up. And listen to that spark, he must be right on top of us.
What's he sending now?
Poker. Business. Good. Ow.
Well, that's it for me. I'm shutting down.
A perfect April Sunday at sea has come to a close. Titanic is making good time, steaming westward at 22 and a half knots. Her engines pound and howl deep within her hull. At about 26 miles per hour, she is running close to her top speed. Her propellers drive through the near-freezing water at a reckless pace. Titanic has almost no margin for quick maneuvers. But the cold, dark ocean around this steam-driven wonder ship barely seems to matter. From the black gang shoveling coal in the stokeholds, to the passengers sleeping in the cabins above them, all aboard Titanic feel safe within the grand machinery of Gilded Age progress.
There have been many shipwrecks, but there was only one Titanic. The details of her sinking have fascinated a few generations of scholars. The courage and cowardice of individuals and sheer size of the tragedy became legends for the 20th century. Hindsight lets us look back to analyze and blame, but when we ask who should have seen the ice warnings, and how many lifeboats there should have been, we lose sight of a larger, more timeless lesson. From the shipbuilders to the White Star officials, from the men shoveling coal to the most privileged passengers, everyone was participating in a consensus reality built on sand. The world simply did not operate in the ways they had been led to believe. Our society is probably working under some popular myths of its own right now. People see this in Titanic's story. They understand that it was more than a big ship filled with famous passengers. They see hubris and tragedy that echoes the ancient Greeks. The Titans challenged the gods, and the gods struck them down, banishing them to the blackest depths. People also see examples of heroism and sacrifice that resonate to the core of everything we feel about human nature. In the end, Titanic is not just the story of a ship that sank, but the story of those who lived on afterward, whether physically or in spirit.